FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.
Welcome. You are listening to the Financial Survival Network. I'm Kerry Lutz. It's October 30th, 2017. Well, there's so much in the news now. We've got indictments coming down. We've got Uranium One. We've got scandals. We've got everything that makes America great once again. Well, by the way, questions, comments, etc., email us, kl@kerrylutz.com. Have to tell you, our RSS feed is a little bit screwed up. I don't understand why, but I've gotten about 20 emails about it. We're working with our podcast server to try to get the problem resolved. And in the meantime, just go to the website, financialsurvivalnetwork.com. You can hear all of our shows there. So without further ado, John Rubino. Hey, happy Monday.
Hey, Kerry. Well, it's not a happy Monday for a lot of people, because this weekend we discovered that the people running the government are corrupt.
Oof.
And I'm shocked. Know, how are we going to get over this shock? Yeah,
I'm shocked. There's so gambling. Depressing. I'm shocked. You mean there's gambling going on here? I am
there
shocked.
There is gambling going on in here. Yeah. But finally, it's actually taking on a kind of a legal framework here, where the accusations of the past few years have actually turned into a couple of indictments. First, they cut a plea deal with this guy named George Papadopoulos, who I've never heard of before this, to basically explain some of the low-level crimes, I guess. And then just this weekend, they indicted and arrested Paul Manafort, who's a fairly big name. You know, he's been in the news a lot as Trump's campaign manager. Yeah. And they indicted Rick Gates, who was an assistant to Paul Manafort. Now, from watching Law and Order, we know how these things work. They go for the small fish first, and they flip them, and they get them to give evidence against the bigger fish, and then they go get them, and so on, until they work their way all the way to the top. So this is the beginning of the process that, if it goes the way the prosecutors would love it to, I guess, would reach all the way to the top of the government and, you know, bring down the whole thing. And we'll see if it's true. So far, a lot of what they're talking about, and this is for both the Republicans and the Democrats, because it also came out just lately that that Hillary Clinton and the Democratic National Committee were the ones behind the financing of the Russian dossier that is supposed to be this compendium of bad things Trump does when he's out in the world running free. The Clintons have denied all along that they had anything to do with it. And they were, you know, pointing to it as a reason that Trump shouldn't be in office. But it turns out they helped create it.
And it was pure fabrication. So, thing was total fabrication, too.
Well, maybe we'll find out now that the funding of it is an actual legal issue because they lied about it. We might actually get a lot of the charges in it verified or not. You know, we'll investigate them and find out more about it. So who knows? But anyhow, basically, that is opposition research, which campaigns do routinely. Okay. And a lot of what Trump is being accused of, you know, if it's, oh, we had meetings with the Russians in order to get dirt on Hillary, that's the same thing. So, you know, there might be some violation of some election law involved here. Mm-hmm. But it's the kind of thing that everybody does, and it's the kind of thing that won't be a big surprise if that's all there is.
Yeah.
It's going to reinforce most people's opinion that the system is corrupt and the people who are gaming the system and who benefit from the system are themselves corrupt. You know, that's already pretty well understood, but it's going to be solidified by something like this. But it's not treason. You know, it's not this earth-shattering thing where there could be the death penalty for what these guys are doing. So far, you know, we'll find out more later, but right now it's just dirty. You know, it's just kind of creepy stuff.
It's so unlikely that there's anything like this involved because, look, they've been tapping his phones, Trump's and all of his associates' phones for months, or they were prior to him getting sworn in and probably even after. And if there was anything there, it would have been released. All right. With all the leaks going on, for sure. Yeah, they weren't even supposed, you know, the leak came out Friday evening that there were indictments coming down on Monday. And you know, they, one thing I will give them credit for is they didn't go to these guys' houses, you know, with the whole SWAT team and lock them up. They just said, you know, come down to the courthouse. They go into the back of the courthouse or the U.S. attorney's office, and they get printed and, you know, and then released, and all takes place. So that to me is a sign that they're starting to pull back. But the indictment, what it does is it gives Mueller a little bit of breathing room that he wouldn't have otherwise had, because he's knee deep, John, if you read the stories in Uranium One, he was on the panel that approved the sale. And at the same time, he was the head of the FBI, and they had documented proof that the Russians were engaging in bribery, kickbacks, and all sorts of nefarious deeds to bring about the sale of Uranium One, which was 20% of the United States uranium reserves, to a Russian company, which is just a front for the government. Rostrum, I think, is the name of it. So this guy does not belong as special prosecutor, and they know that once he's gone, that's the end of the investigation. So hand down the indictments quick, or we're not going to get anything done here, right?
Well, Carrie, you just said something that I think is very important, that we're not getting anything done.
Yes.
But that's the whole government. Trump's administration has not passed a major law. And the Republican-controlled Congress and Senate haven't passed anything major either. You know, literally nothing of any legislative importance is getting done in this government, which you could make a case for that being a good thing, right? You know, if if you're a Jeffersonian libertarian, as a lot of the listeners of your show probably are, yeah, then the fact that the government is paralyzed by all of this stuff is more or less a good thing. You know, they're not passing any new taxes. Very few new regulations are coming online. They're not interfering with our lives in any way that they don't already do. So that you could make the case that that's not bad. So maybe more of the same.
I think it's a good argument. I think it's a good argument. Trump wants to get rid of a bunch of stuff. So that's the unfortunate part, is the things he wants to get rid of, they aren't allowing. But
well, Carrie, you know the Republicans love to get rid of some things, but they like to impose other things.
Yeah.
So and vice versa with the Democrats. You know, they want to control us in different ways, but they all want to control us. You know, everybody's looking for ways to impose their version of reality on the rest of us. And, you know, it's deeply frustrating because the Democrats are all about individual freedom, but they would love to control the economy. And the Republicans are all about economic freedom, but they would love to control our social lives. So in this current two-party system, it's hard for somebody who just wants to be left alone to do their own thing to feel like they have anybody speaking for them. And maybe the best you can hope for, if you're kind of sort of a libertarian, is a government that is so inept that it can't do anything. So it doesn't help you, but it doesn't hurt you either. You know, that's the thing that Doug Casey says, which I've always wondered about. You know, he's got this big thing in Argentina that he's creating, you know, a community there, sort of a gulch of an Ayn Rand. But he says the reason that it works so well in Argentina is that the government is so incompetent that it leaves you alone, which I don't think is a good thing to say publicly necessarily, because the government is going to hear that. But it is kind of a point that beyond a certain point, government incompetence is better than some of the alternatives, which is an activist but malevolent government, for instance, which is what we have a lot of the time here in the U.S. and in Europe and in other places. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we might look back on this as, you know, a better than what came afterwards time. If we end up getting a government that's very clear and very coherent and very active, we might not like that later.
You're so right. It's kind of funny, but it's ironic more than anything. But as long as we have people that want to be in the government, we're going to have these sociopaths that want to control your life, right? I mean, isn't that what it's about?
Well, I mean, the old saying that power corrupts is absolutely true. And the addendum to that is that power attracts those who want power. So yeah. you not only corrupt the good people who went into government to do good things, but you attract sociopaths. And then you end up with a government of the corrupted and the already corrupt. And the only solution to that for that is to never let government get so powerful that it has the ability to mess with you.
Hey, well,
and we're long past that point now, unfortunately. You know?
It reminds me of Monty Python. They had a skit one time and the guy goes, absolute power corrupts absolutely. You know, that's good. or, it's good to be the king, right?
Yeah, yeah. If you've got absolute power, then you just enjoy your corruption, right? And I think that's where a lot of people in Washington, D.C. are now. They love having the power that they have. They love the fact that the government is growing at such a rate that their real estate values are going through the roof. You know, a really good gauge of how corrupt and overreaching the government is D.C. real estate. When it's soaring, that means the government is pulling ever more power to itself geographically. Yeah. Real estate collapsed, that would be a sign that we're moving in the right direction, that the government is actually shrinking and devolving some of its powers to other places.
Hey.
So that would be a pretty coherent platform, I think, for a president to run on. You know, vote for me and I will make sure D.C. real estate collapses.
I don't think I told you this story, but like 4 years ago, I'm driving back from New York to Florida and I'm on 95. And, you know, the traffic is just horrible around D.C. You know, the gridlock, it's not the only gridlock taking place in the Capitol. It's all roads are gridlocked that lead to D.C. And I get off in Northern Virginia, like 60, 70 miles south of Washington, D.C. And it's brand new communities. Everything is new. Strip malls, you know, it looked like something out of Florida. And all these new houses, there were signs all over the place from developers, you know, touting their new luxury homes. And they were all government employees, all of them. It was total, and lobbyists and other ne'er-do-wells, you know, the parasites that grow up around, you know, they're like barnacles on the bottom of a boat. You know, they just kind of naturally grow and prosper with an increased activist government. I mean, it was unbelievable, John. This is a brand new community, and you knew the only reason it existed was because of proliferation of government. It was shocking.
Oh, yeah. Northern Virginia is where all the lobbyists live. And, you know, it's a very high-end bedroom community there. And it's growing because the amount of money that the federal government has to hand out continues to grow, which means everybody who has a stake in the tax code or in commerce regulation or banking regulation or anything else you want to name where billionaires and corporate CEOs are involved, they got to hire people to go there and pay the correct bribes in order to keep their breaks and their regulatory capture levels and everything. And so as the size of the government increases, the number of people that are out there handing out the bribes has to grow as well. And they got to live somewhere. So they pick Alexandria or Reston or one of the other.
This is proliferated,
rich towns. Yeah.
It's proliferated. I mean, they've just come out of like nowhere. And there's no reason for them to exist, or shall we say the reason that they do exist is a very bad one. Hey, so we're looking here. This is yet another example of how we've become ungovernable. Well, one thing, even though Trump hasn't gotten stuff through, he's doing pretty well with the executive orders, rolling back regulations and firing people. There's 13,000 less people working for Uncle Sam since he took office. And there's like 1 million or 2 million less people on food stamps or EBT cards. So he is making an impact to some extent here, isn't he?
Yeah. I mean, he's doing some stuff, but the big stuff, you know, the repeal of Obamacare, right, which was supposed to happen day one, and the renegotiation or the elimination of all the free trade agreements, and now tax reform. These are things that would have a major impact on the world, and the Republicans just can't do it, and Trump can't do it. And part of it is all the chaos surrounding all these investigations. And part of it is that in a lot of ways, the Republicans are kind of like the dog that caught the car.
Yeah.
You know, all of a sudden, go ahead and repeal Obamacare. You know, have it on my desk tomorrow. And Republicans have no idea what to do with that. They've been calling for it all this time. They don't know what to do. And tax reform is, I'm afraid, going to be the same thing because in order to create a tax system that operates along Republican principles, which is to say low marginal tax rates and relatively few loopholes, means you got to you have to offend an awful lot of people. You know, if you're going to close the mortgage deduction loophole in order to pay for lower tax rates, which basically benefit the 1%, are you really going to be able to get that through? So the Republicans are looking at, oh my God, I'm up for re-election in a year and a half. And am I going to cut taxes for rich people and then close the loophole on the mortgages that my constituents have? Am I going to do that? You know, and so they're kind of paralyzed by the fact that they no longer have any viable ideas. And so they can't pass big legislation because their ideas don't work in the real world as the real world now operates. So that's kind of why we're paralyzed. You know, and it was sort of the same thing under Obama. You know, he didn't get as much done as the left wanted him to get done. And a big part of that was because the ideas of the extremes don't play well in a world where pretty much everybody's got theirs and they don't want to give up anything that they've got in order to make something fairer or make it more equitable or blah, you know, or more efficient. Nobody wants to give up anything in order to achieve these obscure abstract ideals. So we're paralyzed.
Yeah, totally. And you know what it reminds me of? This guy, he's an oncologist, a cancer researcher, and he's spending his whole life, you know, cure cancer. And then all of a sudden, he gets a visit from God. God says, I'm going to grant your wish, and I'm going to cure cancer tomorrow. Nobody will ever die from this horrible disease again. And the guy looks up and says, all of a sudden, he's thinking, oh my God, no cancer, like hospitals closing, doctors out of work, nurses out of work, drug companies closing down. He said, could you just wait a little longer? And that's what these guys are like.
Yeah. And then somebody shows up and puts a bullet in his head and steals all his research and burns it. Right. Yeah. That's how our world works, you know? But Kerry, this is what happens when you borrow too much money. You know, the Austrian School of Economics in 1971 predicted this world when we went off the gold standard and all the countries of the world had fiat currencies, which are to say unlimited credit cards handed to them. We were going to get a debt-ridden, sclerotic society that was paralyzed by its own inability to get anything done. And we got it, you know. Human nature pointed exactly at the world that we've ended up with. And the only way out of this now is by the system collapsing. There is no policy mix that gets you in a pain-free way from here to something sustainable. You know, we need the equivalent of those forest fires that keep burning the West. You know, you have to burn out the underbrush to restart the system in a healthy way. And so the West just has to burn. And the financial system has to collapse and take the political system with it. And then, you know, 2 or 3 or 5 years from now, we have the discussion that's really interesting. Instead of just lamenting the state of the world, we actually get to talk about how to rebuild from the rubble.
Yeah, well, at some point, all of this is going to happen. You know it, and I know it. There's no way around it. So is it better that it happens sooner or later? I mean, I guess the longer this goes on, negative interest rates, all these bad things, the worse the eventual collapse is going to be. So maybe we're better off now. But you know what the problem is with it, John, is nobody is prepared for it. And nobody knows what to do here. So what the new world is going to look like, right? I mean, what's it going to be?
It's going to be messy. And that's all we can say about it with any kind of certainty, you know, because so much of what's going to happen will be determined by guys sitting around conference tables under pressure, right? And who just crack and do something that's incredibly unwise because they have no idea what they're supposed to be doing. That's going to happen at the Fed and the ECB and Treasury, you name it. And so the future becomes unpredictable at that point. But, you know, gold is going to go up. And a lot of very expensive stocks and bonds are going to go down. That's all you know with any kind of certainty.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, there's no getting around it. Well, anyway, finally, Jefferson slash Thoreau are having their way. The government is governing least, and maybe that's a good thing. Find out more about it. Go over to dollarcollapse.com. Check out John's extensive work, some of the best writing out there. Check out our site, financialsurvivalnetwork.com. Sign up for both of our newsletters. Email us, kl@kerrylutz.com. Don't forget the Twitter feed's @KerryLutz. The Facebook page is Financial Survival Network. That's it for this week, John. We'll catch up with you. You're going to be away, but we'll talk to you later in the week, next week. So be well, safe travels.
Take care, Kerry. See ya.
FSN Radio. It's all about what's next. Go to financialsurvivalnetwork.com and sign up for your free weekly newsletter. You'll also get three free reports. The Financial Survival Network. It's all about what's next.